Welcome to the Black Sun Syndicate. I'm your host, Bradley Reeves. Many of you know me from the Colette Informant website. Exclusively, we used to do only Legend of the Five Rings. I decided recently to move into other tabletop games. So specifically, we have moved into the Star Wars Destiny game. Many of you also know that my first collectible card game was actually the Star Wars game by Decipher. You'll notice to my right, one of my first decks that I ever dealt with was the Hunt Down and Destroy the Jedi. So what we're going to do is we're going to review all of the cards from the first set. Today's video is going to be the red command cards. So you'll notice here, if you are unfamiliar with the game, I suggest you you check out some of the videos that have already been made on Star Wars Destiny by Team Covenant, by Tiny Grime Games, and by Fantasy Flight Games, who is the creator of the game. There are a lot of videos out there on how to play. This is more of a set review of each, broken down by each of the different colors. So you'll notice to my right, I've got up Captain Phasma, one of the legendary characters from this set. She's got 11 health. The health is in the upper right hand corner. You'll notice down the left spine of the card, if it has any dice, each of the sides will be listed there. In the bottom left hand corner is its point value. Each unique character has 2 point values, so you can play them either with one die or two dice. If you're playing with two dice, it's called the elite version. The point totals are very valuable because deck construction, you're allowed 30 points for characters when you design your deck. So that's going to be an interesting constraint to work around. Now, 11 health is a decent number for a unique. Think most of the uniques range anywhere from 9 to 13 health, depending on which faction or color it is. Each card is broken down. They're either a hero, villain, or neutral. That's just to the right of the point totals. Obviously, you normally cannot mix hero and villain cards, but you can include neutral with either side. Now, Captain Phasma here. The dice sides. What we're going to particularly be looking at, especially on cards that include dice, is there's going to be a number of things we're going to be looking for. Damage sides are extremely important since this is how you typically win the game. The easiest way to win the game, although that is debatable at some point, is by defeating each of your opponent's characters by dealing them damage. The other way to win the game is if your opponent has no cards in hand and no cards left in his or her deck, then you win the game. Deck sizes are 30 cards, and it's relatively you're going to draw a lot of cards because at the end of each of your turns, everybody draws back up to 5 cards So Phasma has a couple of damage sides, a couple of what I call manipulation sides, the focus symbol, as well as the discard symbol. And then she has a resource and a blank. Just about every card has a blank. I think there's a small number that do have no blanks. But the one of the major reasons you're playing her is for her keyword ability. Her trait, she gives the guardian keyword to any of your non-unique characters. There's a non-unique character for each color on the villain side, and a non-unique character each for the hero side. What is particularly difficult about the guardian keyword is the fact that when one of your characters with the guardian keyword activates, you have the ability to resolve one of your opponent's dice that is showing a melee or a ranged damage, dealing the damage to the character that activated, that has the guardian keyword. By resolving that die, it is removed from their pool and goes back onto their character or upgrade. This is an extremely powerful ability. Being able to resolve your opponent's dice and put the damage where you want it is very, very strong. I expect Phasma to be a character that is played quite frequently, especially during the first year of the game at the very least, because of how the Guardian keyword affects other characters you have. When you can control your opponent's dice in a manner in which they are removed, and being able to put damage where you want it and rather than where they want it, it's going to be a very big boon for you. This is certainly one of the uniques on the villain side that is, to me, in the upper echelon because of her power level of dice manipulation and damage. One of the characters from the Kylo Ren starter deck is the First Order Stormtrooper. And it's also a regular rare as well. Now, you'll notice the health is 7, which is the lowest of any non-unique character. The dice, he only gets one dice. Non-unique characters only have one dice currently. He costs 7. Now, as bad as 2 blanks are on the First Order Stormtrooper, he has 3 different damage sides. So, in other words, when he hits something, he's going to hit it hard. When he misses, he's going to miss, as a typical Stormtrooper would. But having half of your die, half of that die be damage, is certainly powerful. He also has a resource, but typically, if you're playing like a deck with Phasma 2 Stormtroopers, you're wanting to hit the damage sides. There are going to be a lot of ways to manipulate dice, remove dice, etc. So I'm not as worried about the double blank sides as some other players are, because I think there are enough ways to deal with that drawback. That's one of the things that makes Star Wars Destiny special. Most dice games that I've dealt with are have it set up where it's very random. And while in this game, the randomness is there, you have ways to deal with the randomness so that it doesn't feel like you're completely crippled by it. So, yeah, two blanks on a stormtrooper are just very flavorful, but I don't think it's as much of a worry as you would imagine. Alright, so up next is one of my favorite characters from the prequels, General Grievous. Ten health is on the low side for a unique. But for his abilities, it's pretty good. Again, he also has three damage sides. Now his damage sides are melee sides, whereas you noticed with the previous two, like the Stormtrooper and Phasma, they were both ranged sides. Now, that is an important thing to note, simply because if you have multiple dice showing the same symbol, you can resolve them together when you take an action, or you can resolve them separately. Grievous's attacks don't typically mesh well with a lot of the red cards. A lot of the red command cards are going to be range damage, and Grievous's are melee. So more than likely, most of the decks that I've seen Grievous paired in are with characters that also deal melee damage, like Count Dooku, Kylo Ren, Tusken Raider. I've seen them paired with. You'll also notice on his dice, his lowest damage value is 2. So he can deal, that's a 2, 2, and 3 for a resource. Those are extremely hard-hitting dice for his character. He's got a one side that's a manipulation. He has disrupt, so that will remove resources from your opponent, a resource and a blank. His cost is a little restrictive. The normal version is 13 and the elite version is 18. So you have to be careful on how your team is built, but he's certainly going to hit hard when he does. So I can understand wanting to do the 18-point version. He also has an ability that before an opponent's character is defeated, you may steal one of their non-ability upgrades, something like a lightsaber or a blaster, which is also very flavorful for him. Take note that the ability will trigger before an ability like redeploy, so he gets to steal it before you can redeploy it on somebody else. So be aware of that. He's certainly going to be a hard-hitting character to look for, and you're going to see a lot of him, I'm afraid. Okay, so our next unique is General Veers, who was the field commander on Hoth. He has 9 health, which is the lowest for non-unique, or for unique characters that I've seen. His point values are 11 for the normal, 14 for the elite. He also has three damage sides. A 1, a 2, and a plus 2. A shield, a resource, and a blink. His action allows you to remove one of his dice to turn a support die to any side. Now, the support cards, in my mind, are a little more difficult in my playing the game because of their, a lot of them are very cost restrictive. When you get above two resources for support, it's starting to get in a range where it's difficult to play, since at the start of each of your turn you gain two resources. So you either have to hold resources, build up resources until you can play the card, or play something else and try to continue the tempo. So that seems to be difficult. Veers is what I consider more of a support character. He is the type of character that is a support character for a theme, in this case support cards, that needs to be protected in some way to keep everything flowing properly. Now, there's no doubt there are some powerful support cards in this, in the first set. Some of their costs are the question mark. So I'm not 100% sure where Veers goes currently. But as we get more supports that we can naturally play, he will certainly become a powerful character in that regard. Speaking of one of the supports, this is a villain support, the AT-SAT. 6 resources. If you're just using the resources that you gain naturally, that's 3 turns worth of resources. You can see by its abilities, however, why it costs 6. 3 ranged, 4 ranged, 5 ranged for a resource, 2 shields, and then 2 specials that completely discard another support from play. Again, right now, there isn't a whole lot of space for something that costs this much in a deck, because it takes so many resources. I haven't seen a deck that can go very high on resources. So 6 is a lot. And if it can ever hit the field, it can certainly dominate a game. But getting it on the field is going to be the difficult part. Right now, I can only think of one deck this could go in, and we won't get to that, and we'll get to that a little later when we spoil his card, and then his partner's card, where it should go. But right now, I just don't see a spot for AT-SAT much anywhere. Now, this one, I see a slot for. First Order TIE Fighter, 3 resource villain support. It's got 3 damage sides. A disrupt, and a special, as well as a blank. Because, you know, stormtroopers probably flying a TIE Fighter, they're going to miss. The special is to remove all shields from all opponents' characters. To me, where you're gonna this is definitely playable. 3 is a little expensive. you know, turn and a half worth of basic resources. But its effects, again, half of its dice are damage. And then the special in a shield heavy metagame, which I'm afraid is certainly going to be a very big possibility. Removing all shields all at once is going to be powerful. You know, some of the decks that I've heard, Qui-Gon based decks are shield heavy. Han based decks are very shield heavy as well. And I expect this to be one of the ways to be able to blow up all the shields, and then while they're trying to scramble to put more shields back on, you can actually start getting your shots in. So yeah, now Veers and this guy, I could see that being a pairing that you'd like to see. Alright, so Commanding Presence. It's a 3-cost upgrade. It's a legendary villain card. It does not have a blank. That's the first one of these that we've seen. Well, that and the outset. It's red character only. Most everything on here is some sort of dice manipulation. It has two different focus sites, a disrupt, a resource, and then two special sides. The special side reads, choose a red die. If it's your die, resolve it and increase its value by 2. If it's an opponent's die, remove it. I've heard a lot of players talking about this card. I hadn't tested it out yet. But they've said that this is one of the... it certainly outplayed their expectations for the card, especially in the command style mono red decks. The focus, besides just the focus abilities to turn any of your dice to the side you want, you have the ability to resolve your dice at +2 or remove an opponent's dice completely. So it does just about everything that you'd want in a card. The only thing that you'll notice cost on upgrades, they're a little easier on costs. So if you see a card with a cost of 3 or 4, you don't have to worry quite so much about the costs here, because you have the ability to replace a upgrade in play and decrease the cost that you have to pay for the new upgrade. So if you played something like a Holdout Blaster that cost 2 on a previous turn, then you could play Commanding Presence and discard the Holdout Blaster and just pay 1 for the presence. So I don't look for the upgrade costs as much as I do on supports, because of the cost reduction factor that you have if you need it in play. Just a little tidbit. All right, so this is one of the starter deck cards, the F-11D Rifle. 2-cost villain card, upgrade weapon, redeploy. So after this character is defeated, you get to move this card to another character. They basically can pick it up and start using it. So again, this is another one that has 3 damage sides. It has 2 range for a resource, +1 ranged, +2 ranged. A resource, a blank, and then it has a special side that also deals damage. You can force an opponent to deal 2 damage to their characters distributed how they wish. So technically it has four different damage sides. Now, what you need to know about the pluses. Those sections that are blue that say plus one or plus two, you have to pair it with a card that just has a normal range symbol, a one, a two, or two for a resource, and or like it's on here, to be able to use it. If you don't have that side, then those are essentially a blank because you can't use them. Now, if you're playing if you're playing this on General Grievous, he doesn't have any ranged sides, so this can be very difficult to use a card like this on him. So be aware of that during deck building. The other part that you have to be careful of because of this, since in this game, each player takes an action and then it goes to the opponent. So if you roll a character and all of his dice that's on him, let's say you roll the First Order Stormtrooper with this dice, and you rolled a one range damage and a plus two range damage off this die. Your opponent now gets an action, and if he removes the die that says one range damage or changes it to another side like a blank, then you currently can't resolve the plus two range damage on this one. So be aware that is a drawback of some of these. So when you're, you would rather have the ones that are straight damage if at all possible because of this drawback. So that it makes it a little more difficult for your opponent to mess with your rolls. Now that being said, this is a fine card. Having four different damage sides is important. Just remember that two of these sides three of the four sides are more restrictive. One costs you a resource and two of them requires another range damage, a regular range damage to use. Now we're going to get into some of the hero cards. Our first one here is Admiral Akbar. He has 9 health. Again, this is slow for a character, unique character. You'll notice his dice are more manipulative. He does have a range damage. He has a discard, 2 focus, which the focus ability is you can spend this die to turn up 2 other dice to any side that you wish. 2 separate resource sides and a blank. He is rather cheap. He is 10 for a normal, 14 for an elite. And his ability is after an opponent plays or discards the last card from their hand, they have to choose and deal 2 damage to one of their characters. This seems to fit Akbar very well. Similar to what he said in Return of the Jedi, it's a trap. He's trying to trap you into making that decision. Do you want to really play that last card in hand? Is it worth you discarding it to do a reroll to take 2 damage? He is this type of support character. He supports a theme. In this case, he supports a theme that is about control, hand control. I'm not sure exactly where he fits. the deck that I was testing him with was a Padme Amidala deck, and while he is a controlling style character, he doesn't automatically fit the plan that I was trying to do with Padme, who is a mill character. We'll get to her when I go over the yellow rogue cards in another video. So I haven't really figured out where Akbar fits currently. He may not fit anywhere, simply because there may not be enough support cards for him right now. But he has some future potential. Now we get into Princess Leia. She has 11 health, so this is slightly above average. Her cost is reasonable. 12 normal, 16 for the elite version. She has 3 damage sides, a reroll, or a focus, a resource, and a blank. She also has an ability to remove her die to reroll up to 2 of your dice. So she can certainly put out some damage, but she also has the backup effect of being able to reroll or fix some of your other dice if you are unable to roll damage with her. So that's really good. She fits multiple roles in one character. I still think of her more as a support character rather than a main character, because her action and her focus side is more pushed toward a secondary role rather than a primary. But being able to have her with another powerful character that can push out damage is going to be really strong, especially with her cost values being what they are. Now we get to the character I was speaking about earlier, Poe Dameron. Poe has 12 health. His normal version is 14. His elite is 18. He has some masterful sides on his die. 2 range, 3 range for a resource, and then his special. A disrupt, a resource, and a blank. His special is to discard a card from your hand, resolve one of the sides of its dice, if able. Then if it was a vehicle card, you may pay its cost to play it from your discard pile. So the crazy part about Poe is that, I mean, he's a build around me character. There are not a lot of vehicle cards in this first set. There are a few, but there's not a lot. And where his ability is going to shine is when you're able to roll his special, and then you can discard the card to resolve one of the die sides. You don't have to roll the die. You just basically say, okay, this is the side I'm going to resolve on the card or on the die. It's resolved. Now there's some heavy hitters. There's a few we're fixing to get to here in a minute. A specific one in the yellow that doesn't look like it's normally playable because of its cost, but in a Poe deck, it's going to hit for a ton. What I like about Poe is it gives you a build-around character as the game goes along. That being said, his costs make him a little restrictive because there isn't a whole lot you can pair him with currently if you go the elite version and try to really push his special. Now for the non-unique hero card. It's a Rebel Trooper, 7 health. He costs 8, which is a little more than the Stormtrooper. He has 3 damage sides, 1 range, 2 range, and plus 1 range. Shield, a focus, or a resource, and a blank. But the important part here is he has the built-in Guardian keyword. Having the built-in Guardian keyword means that you can pair him or him and somebody else with a unique character that you want to build around and use the trooper to protect that character. It would be difficult to play a couple of Rebel Troopers in a third character, in a elite third character, because 2 troopers is 16 points. So I don't know if it's completely viable in that manner. But having a character with a built-in Guardian keyword is certainly powerful as we move forward. So up next we have Launch Bay. 5 resources for a hero only support. It has some busted abilities. Reads the X on this die is equal to the number of cards in your hand. So I have 2 different range dice, 2 different range damage, a disrupt damage, or disrupt shield, a discard, and a blank. Okay. Its normal cost of 5 is going to be super difficult with a support card. But we just were talking about Poe Dameron. Where I see Launch Bay currently is in a Poe deck. You can discard the Launch Bay. You have a hand of 5 cards, so the max damage on here is 5. With Poe, if you resolve this, you could get 4 range damage. You could suck up 4 of their resources. You could gain 4. Gain 4 shields, although you can only have a max of 3 shields, so. Or you can make them discard 4 cards from hand. Now, it's certainly powerful. You get it on the table. It makes your opponent really wary while you've got a full hand because of so much damage. But right now, that's the only place that I see this card is in a Poe deck. Because usually, if you get this thing rolling, even with an average size hand of 3, 3 range damage is a lot of damage. That's a hard hitting card. So, right now that's my only spot for it. I don't really see anywhere else that it could go currently. All right, Black One. This is also Poe's vehicle. 4 cost support. It has 3 sights that does damage. 2 ranged, 3 ranged, and then The special, it deals one damage to a character, and you get to reroll the die instead of removing it from your pool. Four is still a lot. That's two turns worth of play. Again, this is another card I'm not 100% sure makes any other deck other than Poe's build around deck currently. There isn't a ton of ways to easily get to four resources without taking a bunch of damage from your opponent and sitting there. The repetitive damage off this card is certainly something that makes you think about it. But again, right now I don't see it fitting in a lot of stuff. I like its potential, but I don't like the cost right now is very restrictive for me. All right, now we get into some of the upgrades. Scout is a one cost upgrade. Boy, that's a sweet spot. It has almost everything on this die is a manipulation. The two disrupts for a resource, a focus, two specials. The special is something you'll certainly look at. Look at your opponent's hand and discard the cheapest card from it you choose in the case of a tie. To me, this goes in something like an Akbar deck where you're trying to control what your opponent has in his hand, making it really difficult for giving them less and less options. Trying to keep their hands small, maybe even attempting a mill deck, trying to use the other win condition. This is really where Scout shines. And if you're in the market for a controlish card like this in an upgrade at a very minuscule cost, you know, this is technically half a turn worth of resources. This is going to be a very good card going for that strategy. All right, next up is Survival Gear. Two cost upgrade. This one does not have any blank sides, so that's important to note. It has two different resource sides, two different shield sides, a focus, and a melee damage. This is also, again, a hero card. To me, this is an okay card. If you're playing a deck that wants some additional protection, in red, especially mono red, something like this might be exactly what you're looking for on the hero side. It also has the potential to give you extra resources. The shield side, I guess that's really what you're looking at, is the shield side. There aren't a ton of cards, especially events, that give you shields in command. There's a card that heals damage, which we'll get to a little later. But as far as giving shields, there aren't a lot in this color. So if you're in that type of market, this might be a fine upgrade for that. I haven't seen it played in a ton. Most of my games, however, have been on during the preview of the game. You've been seeing it on Tabletop Simulator on Steam. That's where I've been doing most of my games. So again, this is not one I've seen a lot of play in, but not having any blanks is nice. The one melee is kind of strange, since you don't usually do a lot of melee damage in red. Most of it's ranged. But it's a fine upgrade. I just don't, again, other than having the shield sides where it's multiple shields, I don't know what other kind of deck you'd want to really stick this into right now. All right, Outpost. Outpost is a support. It costs 2. This is a neutral support. It has a focus, 2 different disrupt sides, shield side, and then its special ability is to resolve the battlefield ability as if you had claimed it. Now, we were talking about playing a control-ish style deck. Earlier, trying to do stuff with like Akbar or something on the villain side with a little more controlling. This is an interesting support for that kind of strategy. Now the problem is with the special is the fact that you have very little control over choosing the battlefield. Getting whoever rolls the highest before the game starts gets that choice of which battlefield to play. So that may lock your battlefield out. And there isn't a whole lot of ways to switch battlefields currently. As I recall, it was either 1 or 2 cards. So that makes it a little difficult to make this reliable. Now, you may end up seeing a lot of decks that have powerful battlefield abilities that you want to use. This may end up being a fine card for that. As there becomes more cards that allow you to make sure that you have the battlefield that you want, that ability, it will be incredibly powerful. It gives you the ability to possibly hit it multiple times in the same turn. And for some of them, that can be devastating. Alright, now here's a nice cheap upgrade. The DH-17 Blaster Pistol. 1 cost. It has 3 damage sides. 1 ranged, 2 ranged for a resource. Plus 2 ranged. A shield, and then 2 blanks. Certainly the 2 blanks are not great, but I tell you, with that kind of damage output potential, 2 blanks are okay. Now, just like the Stormtrooper, also has 3 different damage sides and 2 blanks. Now this is a neutral card, so it can go in either deck. The upgrade, since it's an upgrade, and you have the ability to reduce the cost of an upgrade by discarding one that you have in play. To reduce what's cost by the one you discarded. You may completely disregard this one. That's perfectly fine. There are a lot of good upgrades at 2 that I like. So this one may just get completely tossed in the corner somewhere. With that said, just know that there is another option. Even if you're willing to deal with the fact that it has two blanks. Most of the time on a lot of the upgrades you're playing anyway, most of the ones you're looking for in a lot of situations are damage sides anyway. So having two blanks compared to having another odd random side and a blank is not that much different. Apologize about the scan of this one. This one I had to rotate and piece together. So this one looks a little odd. We don't have great full-on scans of every card, so some of the ones I had, the images were not great. So again, my apologies, but I want to thank everybody in the Destiny Shapers group on Facebook for helping me get the rest of the images that I needed for this. So the IQA-11 Blaster Rifle. This is a 3-cost upgrade. It's neutral. It has a disrupt and a resource and a blank, along with 3 sides that deal damage, plus a 2-ranged, plus 3-ranged, and then the special that deals 2 unblockable damage to a character. Now, unblockable damage means the shields cannot soak up this damage. So this is a card that gets around shields. I know a lot of people were talking about it because it does cost 3 resources. But right now I've been playing about most of the decks that I've been looking at is somewhere between 12 and 15 upgrades. Or 12 to 15 cards that have dice. And I'd rather play extra upgrades that I can discard later for better upgrades if possible. So having a 3-cost or a 4-cost on an upgrade is, while it's not ideal, it's not backbreaking because of that ability. Having 3 sides that can do 2 plus damage, now that's a decent chunk. You start chunking that together with a character that does 2 ranged as a 1 and 2 ranged damage. You're going to be chunking about half of a character's hit points in one shot, which is great. And the ability to go through shields with this one is actually also pretty great. Don't discount this because of the 3-cost. It's definitely worth a look, and it plays better than you think it does. I say, okay, so we're going to do a promotion, which is, it's a neutral card. 1-cost upgrade, red character only. After you play this upgrade, you may draw a card. It has some interesting sides on this die. It increases range damage or melee damage, a focus, a shield, and a resource. Now, this is interesting for a number of reasons. Card draw is not, I can't say it's useless in the game, but it certainly has a different value in Star Wars than it does any other game that I've played. Since at the end of each turn, you draw back up to 5 cards, or you draw back up to your hand size. Most other games, you just draw 1 card a turn, so seeing extra cards is much more important. In Destiny, with a 30-card deck and you drawing back up to your hand size at the end of each turn, this is not quite as important in this game, and can actually push you toward losing the game if you burn through your deck too fast. Now, on promotion, this is a May, so it's not completely, it doesn't force you to draw a card, so you can choose not to, which is fine. And having the additional dice on your character is fine. But this is not a card I would automatically look at in red and say, yeah, this is a two of. I would be looking for something with more damage sides first, or and even something like maybe Commanding Presence as a non-weapon style upgrade. This is not a card it's not a card I've seen a lot of play on a tabletop simulator. So it may play better than it looks on paper. But I certainly have not tried it. Mostly because most of my decks are more on the aggressive side. So I'm looking to put as much damage on the table as possible, and this doesn't do as good a job as some of the other cards I've run into. Okay, so now we're going to get into the events. This is a villain card, 0 resources. Deal one of your non-unique characters damage equal to the value of an opponent's dice showing ranged or melee, then remove that die. So, this basically, this is an event you can play as an action to deal with one of your opponent's dice. It's not as good as the Guardian keyword. With the Guardian keyword, you're technically taking 2 actions. The first action you're taking is activating your character, and the second action is removing an opponent's die. And pointing the damage at your character. So the Phasma Trooper, Double Trooper, or Phasma Trooper Raider type setups, this is a card that is probably not going in your deck. Other setups where you're running 2 stormtroopers and then a third character, and you want to protect him, and your character doesn't have Guardian, then this is a card I would certainly consider as dice removal and protection for your major character. Again, apologize for some of the image qualities. Closing the Net is a 1-cost event. For villains, force an opponent to choose or remove one of their dice, and then you get to put this card on the bottom of your deck instead of discarding it. So it basically performs double duty. It allows the card to go back into your deck, so you don't technically ever deck yourself. So it's protection for that, and it removes an opponent's dice. Removing your opponent's dice, in my opinion, is the best way currently in the game to control your opponent. That removing resource and keeping them from manipulating their resources. But you have to have some of these cards in your deck. That being said, there are some cards that do this ability better than other cards in the game. This is a fine effect if your deck needs an effect like this, especially right now if you're playing a mono red or straight command deck. I think there are better options in other colors that you might want to look into. But it certainly does the effect that you want, except for that your opponent gets to choose the dice. You would much rather have the ability to straight up remove one of their dice and you get to choose it. This is a fine secondary style effect. So what I look for in dice removal is you get to remove their dice straight up without another cost. Second, you remove one of their dice of their choice without another cost, and then remove one of your dice to deal with one or more of their dice. So again, this is a fine effect if you're playing a straight red deck. If you're playing more than one color or more than one faction, I would certainly look at some of the other options available first. Okay, Endless Ranks. 5 resources to return one of your defeated non-unique red characters to the game with no damage on it. This is a very swingy card. It only targets non-unique red characters for villains, so right now that's only the First Order Stormtrooper. 5 is a huge number of resources for an event. In Destiny, since they're... Even if you don't ever get to 5 resources, you can always discard from your hand to play, to re-roll any number of your dice in your pool. So the card is not completely wasted in your deck. That being said, I don't think I would ever run more than one copy of this card because of its cost and because you literally have to have it sit in your hand for a long period of time if you draw it on early turns, waiting for them to kill that non-unique character, and they may wait to save it till the last character that you have left. So it could be completely worthless. That being said, it is powerful, so it's not something to be completely discounted. Know that it does exist, and be prepared for it. And I typically like recursion because it typically breaks rules. That cost has restricted it quite well, however. All right. Next up is Occupation. It's a 2-cost event for villains. You can only play this if you control the battlefield, force an opponent to lose all of their resources. This is very flavorful for red, for the command cards, to control the battlefield. Be able to play this only if you control the battlefield to do something. Now, depending on the way your deck is built and the way that you play your deck, controlling the battlefield might be difficult for you. So you being able to play this card might be, it may not be something your deck wants. The effect is very powerful if you can control it. There is no telling, however, if you will ever control the battlefield during a game. The card certainly has uses if you have a way to control the battlefield. But the way that works is if you claim the battlefield, you gain control of it. You get to use the claim effect, and then you pass the rest of your actions for the rest of the turn. So it opens you up for your opponent to take multiple actions, if he has any to take. So that is a tricky deal. For me, I would rather a card be useful in all situations, if at all possible, rather than playing a card with some major restrictions. Now, in this first few months of the game, while there aren't a whole lot of options, this may be something that ends up in your deck as a single copy. For me personally, unless there's a way to build your deck where you get to play all of your actions out early, or all of your actions out at once, where you can get to a point to you've decimated your opponent. Your opponent's taken as many actions as he can. Then you take a bunch of yours all at once. Where if you take the battlefield, it's not going to hurt you as bad. I don't see this really slotting in many decks, in my opinion. Probe. If this is a zero-cost event for villains, you get to look at two random cards in your opponent's hand and discard any of those cards that are events. Since your opponent's deck is about half, it's going to be, so far what I've seen in deck building, is about half and half. If you're playing a deck with red characters in it, knowing cards in your opponent's hand is a very strong effect, and B, discarding those cards from their hand is usually a strong effect. This is the type of card I want in most, if not all, red decks. I like controlling what my opponent can do, and this also giving me more information about what's in their hand allows me to play around certain things in their turn. To me this is an auto include if you've got red characters in your deck. Okay, sweep the area, zero cost. Count the number of ready red characters you have. Reroll that many of your opponent's dice. Okay, so dice manipulation. Again, dice manipulation is going to be very important in this game. Now, this card only rerolls your opponent's dice. So this falls into the category of controlling what your opponent rolls. Again, as an effect, I would rather have a card that allows me to straight manipulate my opponent's any dice, and I'd rather have that as a first effect. If I can affect my dice or my opponent's dice, manipulating them to anything specific, I would rather have that first. Rerolling dice is a good second option. I would rather have the ability to reroll, in this case, reroll my dice or my opponent's dice. This to me fits more in a in a controlling slot. And again, this is a fine effect. You're going to have ways to remove your opponent's dice, manipulate your opponent's dice, manipulate your own dice, or force them to re-roll so many dice. So it's not going to be completely wasted, but there are only so many slots you're going to have in your deck, in your event slots. Know that you're going to have a number of each of those effects in your deck to control your opponent. You want more of the ones that remove your remove their dice or manipulate their dice into making them reroll rather than a straight reroll before you get to this effect. Tactical Mastery. One cost events for villains spot a red character to take up to two additional actions. All right, guys, for me, this is a two of auto include. In a game where each player takes an individual action and then the action goes to the next player, effects that allow you to take multiple actions in a row are golden. Obviously, the game that I came from, Legend of the Five Rings, combat was situated into the defending player took an action, then the attacking player took an action. So when you're able to take multiple actions before your opponent gets the next action, it was powerful. To me, this is one of the cards that's going to go into red villain-based builds, because you're literally taking this action and two more. You're taking three actions in a row. And that sort of tempo shift is what shifts games into your favor or lets you take control of games. The Best Defense. This is a one-cost event for villains. Deal one of your red characters three damage to remove up to two of your opponent's dice. Okay, similar to the Guardian ability, this lets one of your characters take it on the chin to remove your opponent's dice. Now, while you would rather have another way to remove your opponent's dice, this is going to be one of the staples of red-based decks. You could even in the Phasma 2 Trooper deck, the troopers, you give your troopers Guardian. They can soak up some of the damage that way. You have the best defense. You could even play this, put three damage on Phasma, remove two of your opponent's dice. Now, the way it's worded, deal one of your red characters three damage. Shields soak up damage. So if you have shields on one of your characters, it will hit your shields first. To me, this is again a way to focus damage on certain characters and remove your opponent's dice. And that type of control element is very strong in a game like this, because once the dice are removed, so far we have not seen a way to ready a character. Yeah, there's one character that does it currently, and one red card, but it's very few ways to get dice back into your pool once they've been removed. So certainly know if you're playing a villain red heavy deck, you're probably going to be seeing something like this. Drudge Work. Zero cost support card. Action. Exhaust the support and one of your characters to gain a resource. Now this is interesting. It doesn't cost you any resources, but having to discard exhaust the support and a character to gain a resource. That's a lot of work for one resource. It costs you an action to play this. And your opponent takes an action. Then you have to exhaust this any character to gain one resource. So you literally have to wait three actions before you get to spend this resource. That's a lot. And exhausting a character in a game where you have to exhaust your character to roll their dice. That's a big cost. I'm not very excited about this card. Now, maybe in a deck where you're playing the four Stormtrooper start, or the three Stormtrooper Tusken Raider start. Maybe you're using something like this to help you build extra resources, but I'm not excited about it. And normally I'm all about free resources, but to me, that's a lot of time between playing the card, activating the card, and a character to do it. It's just, to me, that's a lot of work for one resource. Local Garrison. This is a three cost for support. Each opponent gains one fewer resource during each upkeep phase to a minimum of one. Now, I played a lot of games, and things like resource control is both powerful and annoying. And I personally believe this is a very strong villain card. Three resources is a lot, and there's a reason they did it for three instead of two. Because it takes a turn and a half, or forcing you to roll an extra resource into your pool, thus taking away damage or other effects to get this out on the table. But what this does is it slowly grinds your opponent down. If this is a turn one or a turn two play, the rest of the game they're going to lose a resource each turn. Basically lose a resource each turn. They're now forced to figure out, well, how am I going to... I was basing my entire strategy on getting two resources a turn. Now I'm only getting one resource a turn. So now I either have to sit there and re-roll my dice to get resources on those dice, just to be able to play my normal game. Or I have to find a way to ignore this effect whatsoever. It gets to be a very difficult situation. I've heard other players talk about this card not being as good, but I can tell you, coming from other games, resource restriction is a very powerful effect. Is it worth three resources for it? I think so. And again, this card's not completely worthless. You can always, if you don't feel like you get in a scenario to choke your opponent's resources early, you can always use it to re-roll other dice. So it's not going to be completely worthless. My suggestion is actually try this out. I think that type of control strategy could be viable, and I'm scared that they put this in the first set, honestly. Alright, Personal Escort. One cost upgrade. Attached character has the Guardian keyword. It's a villain-only card. Good news is that this is another way to give your characters guardian. Here's the bad news is it does take up an upgrade slot. You're allowed 3 upgrades per character. Now, if you want a scary combination on an early deck, Grievous, Count Dooku, and put a personal escort on Count Dooku. That's annoying, folks. We'll get to Dooku when we do the Force user cards, the blue cards, in one of my other videos. This is a strong ability on a secondary character. Or in even, like, say, the 4 trooper build we were talking about, the multiple trooper, single Tusken Raider build, where you don't have a character like Phasma that gives your other characters guardian. Or even in that deck, you could play a copy of this on Phasma if you wanted to. The guardian keyword is one of the best keywords in the base set. It may be the best. There's one we haven't talked about yet. We've talked about redeploy. Of the ones we've reviewed, this is the best keyword so far. And this may be the best keyword. The other one is called ambush. We should get to that. We'll get to that later in the red cards. And it's very close between the two. So, yeah, this is a common that I think you would definitely want in your deck. Especially if you're playing a support-style character that's very good at soaking up damage. Dooku is very high on that list. Alright, so Commando Raid. 1 cost event. Resolve when you rear red die showing discard. Increase its value by 2 and then draw a card. Unfortunately, there are not a lot of red cards, especially character and weapon cards or upgrade cards that have the discard symbol. This is a hero only card. It's a powerful effect, being able to discard, increase a discard value by 2 and then draw a card. So you're swinging this by 3. You know, 3 cards. This is an effect that I would look for as the game grows. Right now it doesn't have a spot, but know that this card is going to be powerful as we go forward. Yeah, by the way, if you're playing a mill deck, super good. Alright, defensive position. Again, this is another card that you must control the battlefield to play. A hero card only that costs 1 resource. Remove all of an opponent's die showing a value of 2 or higher. Again, these cards that require the controlment of the battlefield are a little more difficult to grade because controlling the battlefield is it's not something you have all the time. And for me, yes, being able to remove a multiple of an opponent's dice is a very powerful effect. That being said, you have a limited number of slots in your deck, and this is something that you may not want to stick 2 of in your deck, because you just don't have the spot for it. Because this is dice removal that you can't. You can't count on all the time. It's very strong because it removes everything that 2, 3, 4 damage or two, three, or four higher. For note, special sides and blanks count as zeros. So it does not deal with those type. Alright, Field Medic. This is a hero card, one resource, heal two damage from a character. Since they don't have a ton of ways to gain shields in the events and don't have a ton of cards that naturally give shields, if you roll them, Field Medic is a very good card to help mitigate some of the damage. Obviously you're having to pay a resource and take an action to heal two damage from a character. But it's a solid card, and it's something you probably want in your deck, especially if you don't have a way to deal with, gain a lot of shields. Like the mono red builds are not going to have a ton of ways other than hopefully rolling them. So this is something you probably want in those style decks. Other colors are going to just keep a number of shields up and probably not going to run this. Alright, next up is Hit and Run, zero cost event for heroes. Has the ambush keyword. Activate one of your red characters. Now, ambush is the other keyword I was talking about. You may take an additional action after you play this card. So this is why I was debating whether the Guardian keyword or the Ambush keyword was the best of the two keywords in the base set. Again, taking multiple actions is a way to swing tempo in this game. The Guardian keyword lets you, in my opinion, take two consecutive actions. One to roll to activate your character with the Guardian keyword, and two, be able to remove one of their dice. And basically put the damage where you want. Ambush has a similar effect, where in this case you get to activate one of your red characters and then take an additional action. It could be to resolve that character's dice. It could be to play another event like this one. So, in decks where you've got a bunch of cards with ambush or got a lot of cards where you can take additional actions, you're going to gain a natural advantage over your opponent because, in that regard, because you get to dictate the type of play that happens. To me, again, especially in decks that are mono red or have multiple red characters, this is another one of those cards that swings tempo that you're probably going to want a couple of copies of to swing that tempo in your favor. Now, since this restricts it to red characters, it makes it a little more difficult because if your red characters are dead, you're going to be stuck. You're going to be using this card to discard to reroll other dice. It's a trap. So it's a one cost hero event again with ambush. Choose a symbol showing on an opponent's die. Then turn any number of your red dice to sides showing that symbol. So, not only are you getting to manipulate any number of your red dice, but then you get an additional action. Now, you're going to have some times where you're playing the same strategy, the same side, you may be playing a mirror match, which is very possible in this game. You could be playing a deck that's red on red or red on yellow that has a number of matching sides, where this card is going to be very good in those type situations. I'm a little cautious about this because not every matchup you're going to have matching sides. If you're playing red characters, you're more than likely going to be having sides that are ranged damage. Your opponent may be playing a blue deck, which the force users are going to be a lot of melee damage. That's going to make things a little difficult to match sides. I think this card in the right meta is ridiculous. If your meta is going to be a lot of red-based decks, you're going to have a lot of range damage showing and being able to turn multiple of your dice to ranged sides and then maybe resolve one of them or remove your opponent's die, just scintillating. That being said, right now I think it is a trap. For me, this is a metagame style card, and that's where I'm going to leave it. Again, this is another bad scan, so my apologies on it. Natural talent: resolve one of your dice, increasing its value by one. This is a hero event for one resource. It's a good card. It's a good common. It costs you a resource to basically increase one of your dice that you're resolving by one. I'm not sure how many decks you want to put this in. Obviously, there's going to be a number of slots that you want to control your opponent that are going to take up the majority of your event slots. There's a possibility that there's a number of extra slots you've got left at the end, and this will slot into them. This is not a card that I'm, unless you're playing, I guess, if you're playing a very aggressive deck, something like this you might be in the market for. But this certainly, to me, this would be like in the area of 27, 28, card number 27 or 28, 29 or 30, one of the last four slots in the deck. It's certainly fine. I would rather have something that's permanent on the battlefield, though. Rearm. A zero cost event. Play a red upgrade from your discard pile, decreasing its cost by one. Okay, so you know earlier we were talking about being able to discard an upgrade and play to play a new one at a reduced cost. Rearm gives you that ability to recycle that one. The one you discarded at a reduced cost again. So it's, to me, this is like getting free resources. If you're playing a heavy red deck, a lot of red upgrades, you might be in the market for something like this. Free resources are awesome. Alright, next up we have Retreat. It is a hero event for two resources. Your opponent may take one action, then end the action phase. This might be the biggest control card that we've seen. If your opponent starts activating, activates a character and rolls really well, and then, you know, you take an action, then they activate another character and rolls really well. Then you might just say, all right, I'm going to use my two resources, give you one more action, and then we're just going to end the action phase. So now it limits your opponent's choices. He may be running a mix of melee and range damage. He may not have everything he needs. So he gets one additional action, and then that's it. The turn ends. You ready all your characters, dice go back onto your characters, they empty out of your pool. This is a hero card that lets you get out of sticky situations if you need it. Hero sides seem to be a little bit more defensive, and villain side seems to be a little more aggressive in this first set, which is sort of expected. But this might be the best control card that I have seen in red, period. Next up is Strategic Planning, an event for one cost. Ready or exhaust a support card. So it gives you the ability to ready a support card that you have, that you've already exhausted and used for the turn, so that you can reuse it, or it lets you exhaust an opponent's support card. Hey, is that an asset that you haven't rolled yet? Let me just exhaust that for the turn. Hero only card. Again, this is something that is not a card that's going to go in every deck. If you're in a support-heavy meta, you might want to play it in your deck to limit your opponent's choices. Or if you're playing in a support-heavy deck, you may want to add it to your deck to help get extra uses out of your support cards. But it's not an auto-include by any means. Surgical Strike. This is a hero only card. Remove any number of your red dice showing range damage. Increase each of their values by one to discard a support from play that costs equal to or less than the combined value of those dice. So this is a way to permanently get rid of a support card on your opponent's side of the table. Now, we just saw a card that was useful to help your side and hinder your opponent's side for the same cost. Except for this is a permanent removal, while the other is a temporary solution. Right now, I consider this a meta card. This fits only in your deck if you expect to support heavy meta. Other than that, that's what it looks like to me. It's great for what it does. It costs you a lot of dice, though, usually. But if you're trying to deal with something like an Atset, or a first order TIE fighter, maybe something you'll want to stick in there, or even an outpost, as far as that goes. And you know, there's supports in other colors as well, so. Something else we'll talk about in each of the future videos, in each of the other videos. But again, this is a meta card to me and nothing more. Resistance Headquarters, a 2-cost support. Exhaust this support and discard a card from your hand to give a character shield. Then ready the support unless an opponent spends one resource. So this is a recursive hero-only card that let you constantly get shields on your characters. This is a decent card for gaining gaining shields. One of the few red only cards that does this. It does cost you an action and a card from your hand. And it's repetitive if your opponent's not going to pay a resource to stop it. More than likely, they're not going to be able to, or not willing to. This is a decent way to protect your characters in a mono red style deck. I truly believe that there seems to be better options in other colors than this. But if you're restricted on your colors, this is certainly a fine option for that. Award Ceremony, 1-cost event, spot a red character to draw cards equal to the number of exhausted characters you have. This is a neutral event. I said earlier that I don't feel that drawing cards is, additional cards in this game is that important. So far in my games, it doesn't seem to have been. So this is a card that I've sat to the side and said, as the game grows, we find out that it may be more important for an effect like this, then we will start slotting something like this in. But until then, it's bantha fodder. Dug in. 1-cost event, neutral, play if you only control the battlefield. Give 3 shields to your characters, distributed as you wish. Now, while the other cards that are of this type, restricted if you only control the battlefield, I wouldn't put in a deck. This is something that I probably would. You can sculpt certain situations to where you can gain the battlefield, and then your first action, use one of these to pass the shields around to get up defensive. The other two are a little harder, in my opinion. This one seems to be more sculptable in its effect of how you can gain control of the battlefield and then set up to give your character shields, so now you're protected, because when you start the turn with the battlefield, then you get the first action. So again, this is something, now this is something, a card I would certainly look at. Again, I think there are better cards at other, in other colors that are better than this. But if, again, you're playing mono red, the command characters only, this is a very, now this is a fine option. Firepower. Resolve one of your red dice showing range damage, increase its value by one or by two if you're resolving a vehicle die. This again is a neutral only card. Again, so far, more powerful for vehicle cards. Very similar to Natural Talent. This one fits more in a deck that is for vehicles, which right now will be difficult considering their cost. But it's bumping up damage is certainly, can certainly be a powerful effect. Not, again, not sure where this currently slots in, but it is a card too that is noteworthy going forward. Leadership. This is a one cost neutral event. Exhaust one of your unique red characters to ready another character. This is the first card that allows you to ready another character so that you could theoretically reactivate your character, reroll dice back into their pool, etc. Now, if you're playing a support style red character, like a General Veers, an Admiral Akbar, a Leia Organa, and you were wanting to resolve more damage on or get additional rolls, more dice back into the pool after resolving some of them on a turn, you might be looking for an effect like this. If you are playing a pure aggressive strategy where exhausting what your red your unique red character would be slowing you down, this is not a card for your deck. Logistics. Zero resources, spot a event neutral, spot a character, red character, resolve a die showing resources, increasing its damage by one. To me, I consider this sort of a ramp card. If you're playing a deck that's going to be heavy resourced, heavy costed, in red, where you're trying to roll resources to get to your big drops, then I would consider playing logistics in that deck. You know, we were talking before about how expensive Atsat was, how expensive Launch Bay was, even Black One. If that is your plan, then you want to, then you want this type of effect as much as possible. They're either reroll dice or resolve dice with resources to increase their value. Because otherwise, you're never going to get to play those cards. Alright, squad tactics. Zero cost neutral event. Activate any number of your non-unique characters at once. Okay. So, right now, the light side is getting the shaft on this card. Well, no, I take that back. You can play four Rebel Troopers with this. But I think there's a lot more aggressive decks on the dark side that can use this. Where you can drop four Stormtroopers, play something like Tactical Mastery to take two additional actions. One of them, you will play Squad Tactics to activate all of your red characters, and then you can pick and choose to resolve which dice, what die you want to resolve as your third action. A card like this allows you to activate multiple characters at once, is again another card that pushes additional actions. With a four Stormtrooper start, or the three Stormtrooper Tusken Raider, you get to activate all four characters at once. So that's technically taking five additional actions. This action, and one for each non-unique character. Again, that's a tempo swing. If you're playing three or four non-unique character style decks, to me, this is an auto include. And now the last red card in the Awakening set, Supporting Fire, two cost support. Exhaust this support to resolve one of your dice, showing ranged damage, increasing its value by one. Now, this is a neutral card that I would consider thinking about going in my deck because it's a permanent. It allows me to increase the range damage that I have on a die while resolving it. And the majority of your dice in red are going to be ranged. So, yeah, this is an effect I would look at bumping up damage in a heavy, aggressive style deck. Now, again, this is going to take up one of my non dice slots. So there is a space limitation, but it's certainly one I would think about because of the damage bump becomes a permanent that you're going to get that you can get multiple uses out of. So that is a review of the red cards from Star Wars Destiny from the Awakening set. If you like this video, please like, share, subscribe. You can find our website above at colotinformant.com. Find us on Twitter at @colot_informant. We're also on Facebook. You'll be seeing more of the Black Sun Syndicate videos. I have more videos scheduled for the yellow, the blue, and then the other cards from this very first set. May the Force be with you.